Good morning, Praise Center family. I'm so glad that you're here with us today. We are going to have a message from Pastor Ray Mitchell today entitled My Faith and the Great Adventure. But first, there's a couple things we're going to do before that. First, here's some announcements. We are working with our leaders from the different ministry departments to develop content that we can disperse to you during this time of isolation and quarantine. I'm really looking forward to what our leaders are going to be coming up with. Second, we are still receiving offering. We're still receiving offering. You can do that online at pcaottawa.org. You can go to the giving link that's at the top, or there's a big old picture there in the middle of the webpage that you can click on, and that'll give you instructions on how you can still give your tithes and your offerings during this time. You don't even have to leave the house. You can do it from your phone. It's pretty awesome. Today, Pastor Ray is going to be sharing a song in worship, and then he's going to be bringing forth a message that will encourage you and inspire you. Thank you for being a part of this experience. It's online, but God can still move through these services. Would you be praying that God does something incredible? Would you join us in believing that God is going to do things that we've never even imagined? Because that's the kind of God he is. Thank you for joining us today. Here is Pastor Ray.
Good morning, friends. This is Pastor Ray coming to you from deep underground in the shelter-in-place safety bunker. And it's my hope that you are also kind of hunkered down and safe. And my, aren't these different times that we're going through. Speaking of times, I want to talk about a time back a couple of years ago. Actually, it was in 1978. That's longer than a lot of you were even born. You're born after that. In 1978, I heard an album. An album is kind of like an MP3, only it's a big round thing, okay? It's big. And you can play music with them. You can put them on a thing and it plays music. Anyhow, I had an album and it was called His Last Days by Dallas Holmes. And I don't know if the camera can zoom on that or not. But I listened to that over and over again and I fell in love with it. And I said to Jody, one of these days, I'm going to find a way to do that with a choir. I'm going to get a group of people, some of my friends together, and we're going to sing this because it's so good. It was, this was the basis of the Easter dramas that we did at my last assignment. And those Easter dramas actually turned into this, complete with cast, script, songs, sets, lights, advertising, costumes, and sound as some of the main categories. It grew into something very big. I'm going to call that purpose or vision or dreams. Now, it begins with there, but let me back up here for a second because faith becomes such a strong part of what we do. How do we survive this virus environment that we're in? How do we get through that? And I will suggest that our faith is a big part of it. And well, I know it is, because listen to this. In Matthew 9:29, it says this, according to your faith, it will be done to you. So what's going to be done to us? Well, good things according to our faith. And how many times in the Bible did Jesus say to people, this, you're going to be blessed because of your faith. Never have I seen such great faith. And faith was such an important key. And it is for us as well today. So, in effect, we choose how much God blesses us by how much faith we can exercise. Like a muscle, you have to exercise it. Now, in Mark, it says this, everything is possible for the person who has faith. Everything is possible. So, if we have faith, nothing is beyond, totally beyond reason, if it's according to what God has for us. So, I'm going to call these times and this message the Great Adventure, or my faith and the Great Adventure. And so the question that comes to mind then is, how do we get more faith? How do we build our faith? So let me give you a couple steps that maybe will help us today. The first step is this. We have to find godly purpose in our lives. And that's why I was thinking about this, because it was a place where there was a definite purpose, even though it didn't get fulfilled for a while later, was having a purpose. And you might use the word vision or dream or goals or ambitions. But I'm talking about not just our own goals and dreams, but I'm talking about godly goals and ambition and purpose and dream. If God has wired us all up in a specific way to do a specific thing, if we believe that, then we have to ask, what is our purpose in life? And we have to search that out. And if you can't write it down, you probably don't have it yet. Need to pray more about what that is for us. My purpose lately has been to help people to be convinced that they need to read their Bible regularly. It's so important for us. Now, there are many examples in the Bible of people who had great godly purpose. Here's some. Noah. Noah was going to build a big boat. And that was his purpose, and he did that for a long time. How about Abraham? He was going to be the father of many nations. And how about Joseph? He dreamed that he was going to be a ruler. And Nehemiah, he's another one. He was going to build walls around a city. And David. David was going to build the temple, although he didn't get to build it, but his son was able to build it. Here's what it says in Ephesians. God is able to do far more than we would ever dare to ask or dream of. Whoa, isn't that amazing? He's able to do far more than we could ever dare to ask or even dream of. I can dream pretty big, can you? Infinitely beyond our highest prayers and desires, thoughts, or hopes. Wow, what a tremendous thing to hang on to. If a dream isn't big enough that you can achieve it on your own, then it's probably not. When God gives a dream, it's bigger than what you can do by yourself. This was not a one-person effort. This required lots of people to do. Now, step number two is this. What God says, do. What God says, do. This is what it says in James. You must believe and not doubt. A double-minded man is unstable in all he does. So when God says for us to do something, it's like, well, I don't know if I should. Maybe I should. Maybe I should. You know, there's going to take some effort here. And that's going back and forth. When God says do it, do it. Because that's being double-minded. And I will tell you that in order to do it, it probably will cost time. It probably will cost some money. It probably will cost energy from you. And you may even have to let go of some security. Moses had to let go of perhaps becoming the next Pharaoh of the land. Nehemiah had a very secure position, a great position. And he went on to go build a wall. And he left all that behind. So when God says do it, do it. Find God's purpose for your life and then do it. Now the next step is to have patience through the process. Usually there's a waiting period between when you get a purpose from God, a dream, you have a dream from God, and when you can actually accomplish it. There's usually a waiting period because we learn things in the waiting period. So going back to our example of his last days, I believe when I first heard this and said to Jody, we're going to do that, so I'll find a group of people that can sing this. And when it actually happened, it was about 6 or 7 years. There was quite a period of time in between when it first came to me and when it actually, because there was a lot of things I had to learn in the process. There was a lot of things I needed to be prepared for before it happened. And so you have to be prepared and have patience through the process. Here's what it says in our next scripture. But these things I plan won't happen right away. They won't happen right away. Slowly, steadily, surely, really. The time approaches when the vision will be fulfilled. So don't be surprised if you need to have a little patience in the process. We start asking this. Is it going to happen? When's it going to happen? Is it going to happen tomorrow? Listen to some of the things you hear on TV when the press goes after people. Well, when is it going to? We haven't seen it yet. Well, we've sure. And it's just, is it right in the car with your child or your grandchild? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? No. Are we there yet? No. Are we there yet? No. Noah waited 120 years. That's a pretty long time. Moses waited 40 years in the desert. That was a lot of fun. Why do we wait? Because it teaches us to trust God. Step number four, be prepared for problems. We did one of our first performances of this. It was 12 people around a microphone dressed in costume. And I had the bright idea that when Jesus was resurrected, we would bring him back. And we had low technology in those days. We didn't have sets or drops. We didn't have a theatrical stage. We had two spotlights. And so I had this bright idea that I would dress Jesus in white, because everybody knows he's in white, and he would come out in the dark. We turn all the lights off, and we put a black cloth in front of him that he just held, so you couldn't see him. And then I put gunpowder. That's right, you heard it. You heard it here. We had some people that had black powder rifles, and so I took gunpowder and put it in a trough all around Jesus. Doesn't this just sound like a good idea already? I wired it up to a flashlight. So when you turn the switch of the flashlight on, it would go. We turned the lights on, And when the smoke cleared, there was Jesus. He dropped the black cloth and he's standing there. It was a wonderful thing. Now, I had a couple teenagers that had the job of flipping the switch on the flashlight. And I said, whatever you do, do not push this button until the cue comes, until you're told to push the button. Somebody will tell you when to push the button. We had a house, probably 350 people in the house, and we're packed tight. It starts to get hot, and there's all these people, and out of nowhere, I hear, like that. And all the people go, huh? And they look. And I go, I'm going to kill him. Not only did I have to reload the gunpowder, the effect was no longer a surprise. And to make things even worse, everybody was going, choking. Be prepared for problems while you're working on achieving that purpose that God has given you. Circumstances and critics tend to be two of the biggest problems. David was anointed king, but he had Saul chasing him, didn't he? Moses had all kinds of problems, people complaining. They're saying, we don't have enough to eat. We're tired of this manna from heaven. We don't have any toilet paper. This is terrible. What are we going to do? Joseph has a dream of becoming a ruler, and he's sold into slavery. He was in jail for 12 years. Wow. That would be tough. And I've seen some movies where they try to depict this, but here's Moses building this big ark. And Moses? Did I say Moses? Noah builds the ark. I do that all the time, by the way. Luckily, the camera person is on the ball. Jody's back there going, no, that's wrong. Noah. Imagine the people going by him and going, what are you doing? This is crazy. You got to be the dumbest guy in town. The ridicule he must have taken must have been absolutely incredible. Here's what it says in 1 Peter. At the present, you may be temporarily harassed by all kinds of trials. Have you ever felt like that? Harassed by all kinds of trials? This is no accident. Really? It's not an accident. It happens to prove your faith. Oh, which is infinitely more valuable than gold. How do I get more faith? Well, we go through problems. You become stronger. You have seen things. You know that you're going to come out of it. Step number 5. Expect your miracle. I said several weeks ago that there was this writing, Rock of Gibraltar and all of that, that says non plus ultra, there's nothing further beyond. And then when they found out that the earth didn't drop off at that point, they crossed some of it out and it says further beyond, there is more. When you get to that place where it seems like, you know, I got to tie a knot in the rope just to hold on. I'm at a dead end here. I'm at the end of the line. That's when you expect the miracle to happen. There is something further beyond, and you have to have faith to get through that, and your faith will become stronger as you go through it. Think about the disciples. They planned to follow Jesus. They thought they had this whole thing figured out. They thought he was the Messiah, and then he was crucified. And 3 days, they don't know what to do. They're hiding. They're hunkered down deep in the earth, and they're in the security bunker. And it seems to be the end of the line. It just seems to be the end. 3 days. And they start asking, you got to imagine, what's going on, God? Why is this happening to us? We don't understand. We thought Jesus was the Messiah, your son. Did we miss your call? Did we miss your plan? Have we missed God's purpose? Here's what it says in 2 Corinthians. At that time, we were completely overwhelmed. The burden was more than we could bear. Have you felt like that? In fact, we told ourselves that this was the end. Yet now we believe that we had this sense of impending disaster so that we might learn to trust not in ourselves, but in God, who can raise the dead. It's so important that at the end of the day, we realize that it's God that we trust in, not in ourselves. That is absolutely a critical step that we must go through. Well, let me get to the final step here, and that is receive your reward. You will receive a reward at the end of the day. It says in Psalms 27. We don't have Psalms 27, okay? It says, He has delivered and He will deliver us again. Actually, that's 2 Corinthians 1:10. Did I say the wrong thing again? Oh, well. This is just like service. He has delivered and He will deliver us again. In Psalms 27, do you have that? The Psalm 27 next? I was expecting the Lord to rescue me so that once again I will see His goodness to me. Since I don't have it on the screen here for you, and that's my mistake. I'm expecting the Lord to rescue me. I'm expecting Him, and I'm going to receive the reward, so that once again I will see His goodness to me. In Moses' case, He splits the Red Sea. In Abraham's case, he and Sarah miraculously conceive a child. In Joseph's case, all of a sudden his dream does come true, and he finds himself from being in prison in a dungeon to ruling all of the land. And of course, Easter's coming, Jesus was resurrected. God loves turning crucifixions into resurrections. He loves turning dead ends into deliverance, because He gets the credit, and He should, and we give Him the praise. So, let's sum up. If we want our faith to grow, we have to find God's purpose in our lives. Not our purpose, but God's purpose. That's the foundation. Everything else builds from there. Lord, what do You want me to do? What do You have for me? And it could come in small steps. I want You to share Your relationship with me, with this person. I want You to help this person. Maybe work at PADS. That probably won't happen for a while, but it doesn't have to be some big thing. It can be many little things. But what God tells you to do, step number two, what He says to do, do it. We have to take that step. We have to have patience through the process. We have to be prepared for the problems. Don't let that dissuade us. And when it seems bleakest, to expect God to do a miracle in our lives. And at the end of the day, God rewards us and blesses us richly. You know, my friends, one of these days we'll be meeting together back in our sanctuary, won't we? What a great day. I'm trying to imagine what that day is going to be like, but it's going to be a great day. But can we come back stronger than ever? Can we come back more purposeful than ever? Can we come back more committed to doing things for God and being involved? Can we maybe turn priorities? Maybe it's a great time to reevaluate some things, spending more time in the Word, more time with the Lord, searching, asking Him what He wants us to do. Can we be stronger than ever? This time could be very beneficial if it results in that. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank You for these great friends. And Lord, we're all seeking Your purpose. We all want to do what it is You want us to do. I pray You would help us to find that. You said, seek and you will find. So I pray that You would help us to be great seekers. And Lord, at the end of the day, that as we all come back together again, we'll be stronger than ever before. Would You bless each one, Lord, and keep each one safe? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Hello, everyone. This is Pastor Ray.
And Jody.
We want to say thanks for listening. And today's sermon was My Faith, The Great Adventure, and one of the key points was that we need to find God's purpose for our lives. And some of you may be struggling with that for a little bit, so I just wanted to add one thing. You know, Joseph had direction for his life from early on, but a lot of things happened before his final purpose finally happened. He was betrayed by his brothers, thrown into a well. He went to work for Potiphar, and Potiphar's wife falsely accused him. He was thrown into jail. and he was in jail for 12 years. And after that, his purpose finally happened. After that, it became evident that he was able to rescue his family. He rescued a nation, in fact. 12 years. Now, there's some correlation here. I'm not saying the coronavirus is going to last for 12 years.
No.
But I'm saying that things can happen in this period of time that can be good things. And I'm saying that if we really seek God during this time, that we could come out at the other end of this really knowing God's purpose for our lives better than we do now. And that's our prayer for you. But mostly, Jody and I just right now wanted to say, boy, we miss seeing you guys in the foyer and shaking hands and hugging necks and all of that.
We miss connecting with you every Sunday and in our midweek times. We really do. But we want you to know that we are praying for you, and that's a daily exercise for us, and that we are supporting you in every way we can spiritually. Ray goes to the church and prays over the chairs. We're part of prayer lists that are ongoing for some of the things that are happening right now in our families. And God is faithful in all of these things. We believe that. It's also very important. We want to remind you to stay connected socially through social media. Mm-hmm. Make sure that you reach out to people in your iConnect groups and to your friends. It's really important not to become completely isolated at this time. The social connection has power, and like prayer, both are very important in our lives. So that's just a reminder to stay connected.
By the way, for those of you that move around and don't sit in the same spot every time, I might have prayed for you more than once.
You might have.
Watch, as Jody said, for updated information on social media and on our website. We'll do our best to keep in touch with you. Thank you. Jody, would you just lead us in prayer?
Sure. Father, thank you so much for the life that you have given us, for the purposes that you have in every one of our lives, and that you bring it to pass. I pray during this time that our people would not be consumed by anxiety or fear, but that they would know the peace that comes from knowing you, and knowing that you're in charge, you understand what's going on, and you are also the supplier of every need.
Yes.
I pray that we would have confidence in that, and that at this time, that fear would not govern our hearts or our minds. I pray that you would bless every person of Praise Center and every person that is watching this video right now. Thank you that you are a God beyond boundaries, a God beyond our comprehension, and a God who knows us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.